Eli Hemming, welcome to the Single Track Podcast.
Thank you for having me. Anxious to be on.
There's a lot I want to talk about in this episode. I mean, you just recently came on my radar. One of the more well-known figures in our sport, David Roche, was shouting your praises from the mountaintops all over social media. And I figured, who is this guy? I got to take a look. And you have an absolutely fascinating background. And I want to start way back when. Like, you have this extensive time in the sport of triathlon, and how'd you get into it? Like, what made you want to invest so much of your athletic career there?
So, I mean, I started in triathlon when I was about six. My mom did it when she was in college, and she's been a swim coach longer than I've been alive. She brought in, so she was coaching swim. Not all of us were like, oh, like me and my two siblings, we're like, oh, let's do triathlon like mom does. He's like, I'll start a team that's adjacent to the swim team if you guys can each find a friend. And so this was 2002, 2003. And we all find one friend, and she started a triathlon team and kind of been doing it ever since. Well, up until this last year.
Are you somebody who from like an early age was pretty self-motivated in this desire to be as good as possible at the sport came naturally to you, or did you have influences around you helping you get to that point?
It was kind of more just like a for fun thing. Okay. And I think that was kind of one of the best things my mom instilled in me is sport's fun. And like, we're here for a good time. And so honestly, I didn't really start seeing success until kind of later teens.
And there's circuits for it. Like at the age of six, there's other people at that age who are on the bike, on the road, running
in the state of Colorado.
Wow.
So there was quite a few. Like, I mean, I was really fortunate with growing up in Colorado.
Yeah.
There was probably three or four youth races every year. And so I could do that from the age of seven all the way up. And then kind of when you get up into 12, 13 years old, you can start racing kind of around the country. And then once you get into 16, 17, you get to start racing around the world and kind of go up from there.
Well, let's fast forward to that time when you're like 16, 17 years old. Is this like a tipping point where you have the choice to make about whether you want to do things like start to invest in going pro and thinking about like Olympic aspirations and stuff like that?
So, I mean, technically I've held they call them like elite cards, pro cards. It's just like saying that you're able to race in elite races. I've held one of those since I was 17, but that was purely because it's kind of the easier way to do it is through the junior elite path. And it was, well, I qualified for this card, why not take it, right?
Yeah.
And so I did that, but at the same time, you don't really necessarily need to do that. I didn't actually start racing professional races until I was about 20. The junior category is from 16 to 19. And so I raced through that. I left for college. I went to go run in college.
Okay.
And then that next year I was like, that's not really for me. And then I started racing professionally. So it's kind of juniors was an ease into it.
Okay. And are you somebody that is strong suited in one or two of the events, or are you a pretty well-rounded competitor?
I think since I have done it for so long, I was kind of pretty well-rounded, kind of back and forth. And then kind of as I developed and we got further and further into sport, you would think like I would, as I started out a swimmer, I would be the best at swimming, but kind of that turned into my worst. And I started having a knack for running and riding.
Gotcha. Well, one of the reasons why I was curious to have you on is the podcast is going through this fascination with multi-sport right now. Like we just had a guy named Ryan Atkins on the podcast, who's this famous like obstacle course racer, but does a lot of stuff on like the mountain biking circuit and on Nordic ski. He's everywhere. And I'm curious, can you paint a picture of what the triathlon lifestyle looks like? Knowing what you know about our world of trail running, I think the audience would be curious to know what's unique about the tri world.
You know, it's kind of funny. So like with running, you can only train so much. With the pounding, your body can only take, I mean, some people run 100-mile weeks, but my body can't take that yet. And maybe what, 12, 13 hours a week. But for triathlon, you don't have pounding on the, in the water or on the bike. So pretty much you're living a full-time job of training. You're training 30 to 35 hour weeks. And then the rest of the week is spent trying to recover from training so much.
Is there a system set up that allows you to train full time without having to worry about like outside gigs to support yourself?
So yeah, USA Triathlon does actually a pretty good job of when you kind of reach a certain level.
Yeah,
they have a funding like stipend that they give to their top athletes. So it's tough to get there.
Yeah.
So actually, like the hardest part of a professional triathlete is getting from kind of that 10 to 15 rank up into the top five. Cause then you can start getting money from USA Triathlon, or if they, you show that you're kind of really getting into it. They even have discretionary spots. So they're amazing about paying their athletes. It's never that way. It's not like you're making it big or anything, but it's enough to get by.
Enough to not worry.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. And it's wild to me that, yeah, the limiter in the trail running world is physical. Like you hit that 15 hour, 20 hour barrier and it becomes a question of how well can you recover? Whereas it sounds like in the tri world, sky's the limit and you're limited by like, how hard do you want to work? Like, do you want to put in 30 hours? Right. Is that about right?
Yeah. So no, I mean, there's always those rumors about some people like, oh yeah, they're training like 40 hours a week. We'll see what happens to them. Like, I think your body can only absorb what it can absorb, but like kind of that comes along with elite sports is the bodies that can take the pounding, can take the hours,
yeah,
kind of rise up and they don't get injured. So.
And how do I want to put this? Like, is triathlon similar to other sports where you are peaking 1 to 2 times a year and you're like organizing your calendar around like some like spring event and an early fall event, or is it different?
No. So it's kind of like pretty much from races start in about March.
Okay.
And go all the way until, well, the biggest races kind of end, kind of like September, October kind of time.
Okay.
But like you can race pretty much all the way till December if you want. And so people try to stay kind of as fit as possible. You're never peaking, but you're always very fit.
What are the marquee events in the sport?
So there's, it's now the, so it was the World Series. And then they, it was, so WTS, World Triathlon Series.
Okay.
But then they changed it to, I think it's WTCS now. I left at the perfectly wrong time, so I don't know anymore. They changed it as I was leaving. So I don't know what that even stands for anymore. But that series is kind of the top of the top right now, ITU racing, the draft legal style.
Are you traveling like across the US, or is the sport concentrated in like the Mountain West and the West Coast, like trail running is?
It's mostly international actually.
Really? Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah. So I've spent a lot of time out of the country. There's, no World Series races in the US right now. There's every once in a while they'll do like a Chicago, but not too often. I think it's kind of hard to find a town or a city that's willing to put up with closing down all those streets for just a bunch of triathletes running around in tight clothing.
Yeah. Yeah. Were you, given how much you had to invest in it, it's also like an expensive sport too. Were you somebody that was excited to devote such a large amount of your life to like getting ready for these events and competing? Like, did that come naturally to you?
Yeah. I mean, so it was kind of, I was kind of fortunate, like getting into it from so young. I had such great support from my parents. I would definitely wouldn't have been able to do it without them. Just cause the starting cost is kind of astronomical.
Yeah.
So you kind of find that triathlon is a higher income sport if you're getting started later on. Getting started later on. And so I mean, I was really fortunate getting started so young. By that, I mean, I had all the bikes and all the helmets and I had suits and everything. But also going through the junior categories, I was already on USA Triathlon's radar. So it didn't actually take me that long to get on to the funding that I talked about earlier.
How far did you ultimately take it? Like, I think we talked, you know, we talked offline. You mentioned that like Tokyo was a possibility, the Olympic Games were a possibility. Can you talk about like exactly how far you took it with the sport?
Yeah, so I was ranked, well, I've been ranked number one through three pretty much consistently over the last like 4 years.
Okay.
And then kind of over COVID and everything, I went through an injury and all that, and kind of the races didn't quite line up for me, so I didn't end up qualifying. I actually kind of timed it perfectly wrong, where the qualification process of qualifying spots for the US, I was supposed to get that third spot for the US. Cause, if you have, it's like basically three guys in the top 30 in the world rank, then you get three spots to the Olympics.
Okay.
But I fell out of that during my injury. And so we only got two spots, and then in that qualification process, it was like, oh, and definitely not in.
What went into your decision-making process to not give it a run for 2026? Given, I mean, it sounds like, you know, you love the sport. You had a lot of support around you. It came naturally to you. Given that you were right at the top of the sport and you just kind of faced unfortunate injury circumstances. Yeah. Talk about that decision.
Yeah. So, I mean, I was really enjoying myself. I was having fun. I was traveling a lot, but I think it kind of comes down to fulfillment, to kind of to get myself to be able to train at that high of a level and race at that high of a level. I kind of had to do like I kind of had to go into a recluse mode where I did pretty much nothing besides train and race. And so kind of just to do that, it was a very selfish lifestyle. And I mean, I could only, so I coached as well.
Yeah.
And I've always coached. But I was only able to coach and put in the time for like two or three athletes at a time. And that was kind of where I was finding like a little bit more fulfillment.
Okay.
And so when I wasn't even able to put in the effort that I thought those people deserved, I kind of felt like that was a bit wrong. And so this is kind of my search for fulfillment, honestly.
Very cool. I mean, you know, you picked an interesting sport and maybe the perfect sport because, I feel like ultra running is unique in that the athletes here come at it from so many different angles. There's people that have entered as through hikers from the Pacific Crest Trail, lacrosse players, football players, traditional track and field, try. It's funny how it can be a melting pot. One thing I always ask people that are just getting away from a previous sport, is there anything, now that you've been in this world, this trail world for a little bit, is there anything you miss about the triathlon world that like you think the athletes and the fans and the coaches do well over there that's maybe missing here in the trail world that we could think about applying to make our community better?
It's hard to say, like, I mean, I haven't been in the trail world too long. But like, I think the thing that I miss the most personally is, well, it's a love-hate relationship with travel for me.
Yeah.
I hated traveling, especially with a bike. But actually being overseas, and I think that's something that is kind of in my future. Like I want to get back to a level that I can travel to Europe, do all this. But like, it's definitely something that I miss.
You're probably aware at this point of like the Solomon Golden Trail series over in Europe, like the Zagamas and the Mount Blanc marathons. Are those on your radar? Yes.
Me and my wife just signed up for Sierra's Now.
Oh, right.
My wife sent a very nice email saying, the stupid Americans didn't sign up in time, but would love an opportunity to race at your race. They're like, we'll see how it goes.
I love that. Well, okay. We'll definitely talk about that later in the conversation, but, one more question I have on the triathlon front. Do you have any inspirations in that world that, maybe made the jump over to the sport as well? Like, are there any ex triathletes that are here in the ultra world, they're like, oh, right on. Like they made the jump kind of successfully.
You know, I don't know too many names that have actually made the switch over.
Okay.
I have an old buddy that actually reached out to me. So I raced with him in juniors, and all of a sudden, like, he reached out and was like, "Hey, I'm doing ultra running too. We should meet up." and it's funny because he's from Canada. And all of a sudden he came down, lived in our house in Boulder for like a week.
Yeah. Well, what was your initiation to the sport? Like, how'd you hear about ultras? How'd it come on your radar? Who were your influences?
So in high school, for cross country, my coach, he ran the Leadville 100 every single year. Absolutely loved the Leadville 100 race. And he would bring his, varsity team to pace for him. So I've paced over Hope Pass a couple of times, and I paced the last 20 miles with him.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So and once you're at an event like that, that's kind of so iconic, it's hard not to fall in love with the sport.
So that left a pretty big impression on you. And I'm guessing that was 5-10 years ago, and it's just kind of resonating now. And you're like, I remember that, and I'm ready to.
I've always thought about it.
Yeah.
I've kind of always thought, I always said like, oh yeah, like one day I'll get back to that. Earlier it was kind of like, yeah, maybe I'll get back to that when I like retire from triathlon. And then all of a sudden, like, triathlon retirement came a lot earlier than I thought.
You said earlier that you were based in Boulder, and I'm curious if Boulder is a center for a lot of fellow high performing triathletes, like it is trail runners. Is that like a big center?
Absolutely. Okay. Yeah, it is. So we're actually, we just moved. So we're not in Boulder anymore. But we're still coming back every once in a while because it's hard to stay away too much from Boulder.
So where are you going?
So we, my wife, her family has a cattle ranch up in Kremlin, Colorado.
Oh, right on.
Little tiny town. And so we just moved into grandma's basement, helping out on the ranch a little bit. I put on a cowboy hat, and I'm saying technically I'm a cowboy. Cause...
Honestly, I think one of the secret ingredients for success in our sport is time on feet and manual labor. Like, in addition to all the work you do, just like running and lifting weights and stuff, that cumulative time on feet makes a big difference, especially once you get into if you ever like decide to do like the Leadvilles.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Chasing around cows would do me good.
Well, man, I was doing a little bit of homework on you. You've made a splash in the sport pretty quickly. You got second at Way Too Cool 50K, which very well known in our sport. I think you came in second only to the great Tim Tollefson. You won the VK and the 26K at Broken Arrow.
Second place, both those.
Second place. Sorry, second. Well, still, yes. Podium. I mean, again, this was the most competitive Broken Arrow to date by a long shot. I guess I'm curious, like, was this all just like raw talent? Because you say you're still exploring the sport, or were there people you were taking advice from? Do you have a coach? How were you preparing for this stuff?
So yeah, David Roach coaches me.
Okay.
So I'm learning from the best. I come up to him with all these questions all the time. Like, how do I actually run downhill? and kind of we're on a mission, just where me and my wife are signing up for all the hard races we can find, like trying to find all these amazing runners to run with, and like kind of trying to learn from what they're doing.
Yeah.
So the goal is sign up for all the races to get the teeth kicked in a little bit and figure out how to best do it.
I know he's famous for really thinking in the long term for all of his athletes. Like, you may be thinking in the moment about like the US Mountain Champs next week, but I'm sure he's thinking like 5, 10, 15 years down the road. Do you think about like that amount of time in the sport and your goals over long periods like that?
You know, I've tried thinking about it, but currently I'm signing up for a little bit of everything. I signed up for like the fastest 50K I could find, which is Way Too Cool.
Yeah.
And then I also signed up for the slowest 50K I could find, which is Speed Goat. But then like, we're kind of playing in the shorter distances. So we'll kind of see. Like, I think biggest thing is finding like what I'm finding the most joy in, and what I can see. I don't know. Just see how we do.
How many? So it sounds like you have a full schedule. How many times are you going to race this year?
Quite a few.
Like, you've got Speed Goat, you've got Europe.
Let's see. So yeah, I got Speed. All right. So Whiteface this weekend.
Yeah.
Speed Goat coming up. Sears and all. And then September's kind of crazy, actually. So we're going to do Run the Rut, Pikes Peak, and Sky Peaks. And then after that, we're going to take a little breather and see kind of where we are. And then I'd love to go back to Moab Marathon. Did that one last year, and it was so much fun.
Wow. And these are all like marathon. Are most of these, I know with the Broken Arrow stuff, it was shorter, but from here on out, is it mostly marathon distance and up?
So I'm doing the shorter Run the Rut.
Okay.
So 28K, I mean, that's still a big race at Run the Rut. It's so intense. 28K, Pikes Peak, I'm just doing the ascent, so okay. Half marathon. And okay. Then Sky Peaks is at 26K, I believe.
Okay.
So kind of all playing around up there.
I have a couple, well, putting your coaching hat on for a second, I have a couple of questions because I play around in like the ultra scene where, you know, I might do two or three races a year and I have these long, like 12 to 16 week training blocks. I'm curious how you think about fitness and how you think about putting together training blocks and peaking and such, when you have that full of a schedule over such a condensed period of time.
Right. And I think it kind of comes down to a similar thing to what I was doing in triathlon, where I might not be peaking for yeah. most of these events, but I'm showing up just overall as fit and as strong as I can be.
Yeah.
I don't know if, I don't think your body can actually take peaking, that many times. So, kind of one of the things is, especially in like September when I'm racing three times in a row, pretty much, I think we have a week in between, Run the Rut and Pikes Peak. Kind of the name of the game there is more of recovery, and less of actually putting in more hard work, because the races themselves are such hard work. Mm. And you kind of have to treat those are such huge stimuluses.
Yeah.
Stimuli. And we just need to huge stimulus recover enough so that we can have another one. So it won't be like we're doing any big training or anything in September, but, I think we'll actually maintain fitness pretty well,
cool.
Doing those big races.
Yeah. Well, it's cool to me too, because, you know, part of the beauty of the sub ultra world is you do get to race so frequently without having to worry as much about burnout and injury. And I think that the feedback system is awesome, and maybe you aren't as prone to overthinking performance as much. That's just my outside opinion. Like, I feel like in the ultra scene, because you race so infrequently, you probably put a lot of undue pressure on yourself, and there's a lot of anxiety around performance. Do you feel like you have a little bit more freedom, like mentally, when it comes to these races? Cause there's so many of them.
Yeah. And I think, I mean, being so new to the sport, I think that's kind of one of the best parts, is I don't have any self-imposed pressure. That was one of the things in triathlon that was not the best, is self-imposed pressure.
Yeah.
Everybody was happy with how I was doing, but it was always like, but I think I can do better. That's one of the really, really nice things here, is like, I'm just here having fun. I'm a hobby jogger right now. I'm just going out playing in the mountains, and I would love to see just how fast I can go over them.
Yeah. I said I wouldn't bring up tries again, but I have one more question. I'm curious, is there anything that you are bringing into the ultra world from your triathlon training regimen that you think is still applicable here? And maybe you've talked with Coach Roach about it and it makes sense, but maybe it's not necessarily something that like trail runners like myself would think about as useful, like time on the bike or something like that.
Yeah. So, I mean, I truly believe that kind of, it's tough to say, but honestly, to an extent, more time is a little bit better for your aerobic system, at least. And I think that being able to cross train as well, like, I mean, I was a professional cross trainer for 6 years, basically.
Yeah.
So,
good way to put it.
I think being able to do all that extra work, and it's as a, something that I enjoy doing. That's something that David and I talked about is, I am coming from the most, like one of the most aerobic sports you can do. And it's now we kind of did like a short period of like, okay, let's take all that away, learn how to run fast. This last year was the first time that I had experienced booty lock from like too much lactate in my system.
Yeah.
So we kind of learned how to do that now that we're here. And we've kind of grown through that. we're starting to kind of build up again with the cross training, whether it's hiking, whether it's cycling, whether I haven't got back in the pool. I'm not going to do that for a sec. but what I think hours is kind of one of the things that I'm bringing over. You see it a lot in like cross country skiing is another sport that does a similar thing.
Yeah.
Where it's kind of time is a very nice thing to have.
Yeah. Yeah.
A nice thing to be able to do for an aerobic sport.
Let's talk a bit about the fact that you're a coach as well. How did you get into that profession, and maybe talk about your philosophy and who inspires you in that realm, and like what kind of athletes you coach?
So I've been coaching, probably since I was about 20. As pretty much as soon as I started doing professional sports, and I was like, I kind of wanted to hop into it. My mom being my coach from basically when I was born, or when I could swim across the pool, all the way up until I was 19. She was probably one of my biggest inspirations on that. I loved how she did everything. Kind of her philosophy is like the joy of doing it. And I think that was kind of why I found success in sport, is through joy. It's something fun to do. It's not something to take overly serious.
And
that's kind of what I try to instill in my athletes, is this is a really fun thing that we get to do. We're going around and playing in the mountains. Cause now most of the people that we're coaching, we still have a few triathletes here and there. Me and my wife have the coaching business.
Okay.
And we coach mostly just runners now. Just a few here and there of, a few cyclists, a few triathletes, but mostly just runners. And we've kind of had some of the best coaches. I think one of my triathlon coach was amazing, Ian O'Brien. And I've learned a lot from him, whether good or bad, like to throw a little shade on him. coming into this sport and going through like David Roach, I love his philosophy on a lot of things. Cause it's a very similar, I think that's why we matched so well. It's about joy.
Yeah.
It's about happiness. It's about fun. And that comes with hard work, but it's fun. It's fun hard work, and hard work should be fun.
You mentioned your wife earlier, who I understand is also, you know, at the top of the sport. She's an elite athlete, and I have to assume it's awesome having a partner who is, doing similar life work as you. But can you talk specifically about some of the benefits in that relationship? Like, is she a fellow training partner, and are you doing a lot of the same races, stuff like that?
She's over there dancing. she is my only training partner at the moment, actually. We do all of our easy runs together. Pretty much when the hills get too steep or too technical, I usually go to the top and come back for her. We'll have different workouts during the week. So like sometimes,
yeah,
we'll even warm up together, and then we'll go our separate ways. Like we'll find a trail that, yesterday we did this, climb, and it was a 20-minute climb for her, and I had just like 2-minute hill repeats. So we found a climb that we could run the 3 miles over together, and then say, all right, love you, bye. And she took off, and I just kept going up and down this little hill. It's amazing. It's something that we kind of found together, and it was actually kind of her that got me over.
I was going to ask, was she in the sport before you?
So it was kind of about the same time.
Okay.
It was, she was, running track and cross country, at CU. And then she was going to do post-collegiate running, kind of went through injury there. It started up with David. That's kind of how we first got introduced. And then she kind of realized, wow, I don't actually love track. rightfully so. and then she was like, well, David's doing a trail race this weekend. Maybe I'll go race with him. And she was actually the one that talked me into, like, she knew I wasn't the most happy with triathlon at the time.
Yeah.
She was like, why don't you come try this with me? And so I think she was one of the best parts about that is that we get to do it together. And so currently we're doing the same races. Even she's doing the shorter distance at Speed Goat. Okay. She likes the shorter distances and I like the little bit longer ones, but, we're finding a good combo and we'll see if we keep going the same exact races, but so far it's been great.
Right on. Well, all I got left for you is our rapid fire questions. And the first is, what is something that you used to believe strongly? It could be in the tri world, the running world, somewhere else that you've recently changed your mind about and why?
You know, that's, I think it's kind of my life trajectory. I thought I was going to go all the way through, LA 2028. I was going to go through all of those cycles trying to qualify for the Olympics. And then I was going to go to like 70.3s. I never thought Ironmans, but I probably would have done
Kona,
that.
Stuff like that.
Right. And then all of a sudden we're here, kind of made some life choices and super happy about them right now.
You know what? I got to ask you one question on that thread, actually. I've always wondered if this is an equivalent. Is the world triathlon circuit that you competed on to track and field what Ironman is to ultras? Like, do people that are in the scene that you were in think of Ironman as like the cop out for people that aren't fast? In the same way, like if you're on the track and field, they're like, oh, you're doing ultras, like, you know, you're not fast.
A little bit, yeah. There's a lot of trash talking that goes on. Actually, it's kind of funny. So they've started doing a lot of races that they bring in the draft legal guys and the long course guys.
Okay.
And they have them go head to head, which is so awesome.
Yeah.
And it's so fun. And that was one of the races that I wish I would have done, is actually get to race with those guys, because there is so much trash talk going between the two.
That's really funny. Yeah. And as an aside, like there's like a famous Scott Jurek story, who obviously is a great athlete in our sport. Like even back in the early 2010s, when he was still like at the height of his powers as an ultra runner, he would always be the first runner in any conference recognized, even over these like marathoners that were like 210 guys. And I wonder if it's the same for like Lionel Sanders in the Ironman scene versus people on like the faster circuits. Just because there's like the shock value of like longer distances, more exotic locations, stuff like that.
Yeah, no, it's even like one of the wildest things is through sponsorships.
Okay.
You notice that it's harder as a draft legal triathlete to get sponsorships.
Really?
Which kind of, when you think about it, like it a little bit makes sense. So the long course athletes, it's more similar to at the trail scene where they actually get to race with the age groupers, with the average Joe. Whereas our races, we didn't even see people. We were going to these random places. Like we'd go to Abu Dhabi and we'd race on this closed circuit on the F1 track. And like, they could see us online if they wanted to, but it's not like they actually got to be in person with us.
Yeah.
So it's very different worlds.
Crazy. Next question. What's a recent book, movie, podcast episode you've come across recently that has left a good impression on you and you think their audience should know about it?
The book, Open by Andre Agassi. It's about amazing book, isn't it?
I haven't read it. Just heard about it.
You haven't? Yeah. Okay. Yeah. It is an amazing book. It's a biography about Andre Agassi, tennis player. I don't know anything about tennis, but it was an amazing book to read. And it kind of ties in a little bit to what change I just made. Like, he didn't enjoy tennis, but he was the best tennis player there was.
Wow.
Yeah. And you kind of went through this, all his mental struggles and everything. And kind of, it brings back to life is too short to not be enjoying yourself.
You know, what's interesting about that, not to get too philosophical, but I feel like, you know, maybe initially you might not like something, but a lot of people end up loving something just by virtue of the fact that they get really good at it. And it's interesting that he got super good at tennis, and even after getting super good, there still wasn't any joy there, just as a function of like excellence, you know?
Right.
Very interesting. Yeah. I got to read that. When you asked me,
it's definitely worth the read.
It reminds me of the Michael Scott quote. I don't know if you watched The Office, but he's like, you know, have I read it? I own it, but no, I haven't read it.
But no, I haven't.
Two more questions. Who are your favorite athletes to follow on social media and why?
My wife's pointing to herself, but she doesn't post ever, so she's not fun to watch. I love following like Killian.
Yep.
Obviously, how can you not? He posts amazing videos of him running on these like crazy little mountain ridges, and I don't think I could do it. Like, I don't think I'm brave enough for that.
Yeah.
Gosh, who's another?
How about on like the tri scene or the Ironman scene?
There's a triathlete named Gustav Eden.
Okay.
He's a Norwegian and he's hilarious. He seems like he is the always like super serious guy. And then he just like pops out these little jokes and they're fantastic.
That's awesome. Last question I have for you. If you could put a message on a billboard for all to see, what would it say and why?
Do it 'cause it's funny. One of my main motivations for a lot of the random things I do is because I think it's funny. It doesn't have to be funny to anyone else. Often it's not, but I think you should do things because you think they're funny.
And there's a lot of absurdity in our sport too. So you're in the right place.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, man, it's been great to get to know you. Thanks for giving us some insight into your background in tries and in this move into the trail scene. I'm super excited to follow the rest of this season. I'll make sure to link to all your socials in the show notes. And if you have a coaching page, we'll link that too. Anything else you want to leave the audience with before we go?
Just thank you so much for having me. I'm really excited to be part of your guys' world. And we'll see where this takes us.
Right on. Thank you.